Good morning. Morning. It's good to see you all and good to be here. Let's go ahead and open up in a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be here. Father, we thank you for the holiday that we just celebrated, a time of giving thanks. And Father, we just rejoice for everything that you have blessed us with. Father, at this time we come before you, we ask your blessings on this time of fellowship, time in your word, time of singing, and we lift it before you. Pray that it be an honor to you in your name. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, let's turn over to page 192. Page 192. O little town of Bethlehem. Can you have everybody hear it okay? I have a doctor's appointment on Friday to go get my voice, you know, the doctor that does the voice exercises with me. So I'd appreciate your prayers on that. But, you know, I'm going to try and sing this morning because I just love to sing praises to the Lord. And this song that I was wanting to sing is called The Gift of Grace, because if it wasn't for Jesus coming as a baby to grow up, to die on the cross for us, we wouldn't have salvation. We wouldn't have the gift of grace that's free. All we have to do is accept it. And so that's the song I want to sing about today, because Christmas is coming up. We're going to be getting lots of gifts and giving lots of gifts. But this is the greatest gift we could ever get. Time we met, I was living life with deep regret, but I remember well that sacred place where I received your precious gift of grace. The gift of grace is free to all who choose to come to the cross where the Father gave his only Son. I'll never understand why he loved the common man so much that he would die in my place. I'm so thankful for the gift of grace. I'm so thankful for the gift of grace. Here I am with you again. Parted from the burdens of my sin, guilty and ashamed of my mistakes, within you extend your endless gift of grace. The gift of grace is free to all who choose to come to the cross where the Father gave his only Son. I'll never understand why he loved the common man so much that he would die in my place. I'm so thankful for the gift of grace. I'm so thankful for the gift of grace. The gift of grace is free to all who choose to come to the cross where the Father gave his only Son. I'll never understand why he loved the common man so much that he would die in our place. I'm so thankful for the gift of grace. I'm so thankful for the gift of grace. Thank you.
At this time, Father, as we open up the last portion of the book of Ruth, Father, we just pray that you just speak to our hearts, Father. Help us to see the blessings of the reward of salvation that we have through Jesus Christ. And we just lift this time before you now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay, if you would, please open up to Ruth chapter 4. We're going to finish off the book of Ruth today, starting with verse 9. Ruth chapter 4 and verse 9. Okay, Ruth chapter 4, starting with verse 9. It's not working up here, is it? Having some difficulties with this thing. All right. Hopefully you can at least see part of that. I know it's small, I'm sorry. Always some kind of technical issue, but we'll do what we can. Ruth chapter 4, starting with verse 9, says, "And Boaz said unto the elders and unto all the people, ye are witnesses this day that I have bought all that was Amalek's and all that was Chilion's and Mahlon's of the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth the Moabite's, the wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren, and from the gate of his place. Ye are witnesses this day." And all the people that were in the gate and the elders said, "We are witnesses. The Lord make the woman that has come into thine house like Rachel, like Leah, which too did build the house of Israel, and do thou worthily in Ephrathah, and be famous in Bethlehem." And let thy house be like the house of Phares, whom Tamar bare unto Judah, of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman. So Boaz took Ruth, and she was his wife. And when he went in unto her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bare a son. And the woman said unto Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord, which hath not left thee this day without a kinsman, that his name may be famous in Israel. And he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life, and a nourisher of thine old age. For thy daughter-in-law, which loveth thee, which is better to thee than the seven sons, hath borne him. And Naomi took the child and laid it in her bosom and became nurse unto it. And the woman, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, there is a son born of Naomi, and they called his name Obed. And he is the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the generations of Phares. Phares begat Hezron. Hezron begat Ram. Ram begat Aminadab. And Aminadab begat Nashon. Nashon begat Salmon. And Salmon begat Boaz. And Boaz begat Obed. And Obed begat Jesse. And Jesse begat David, which of course is King David. And if you have your outlines there with you, first point is the reclaimer. The reclaimer. Boaz purchased Ruth. Boaz purchased Ruth to raise the family in the name of the deceased man, Mahlon. He was following the laws and the guidance and as described in the Torah, which is the first five books of the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. In as translated in the New King James, it says Ruth, or it says that it was acquired. Ruth the Moabite is the widow of Mahlon, I have acquired as my wife. The Young's Living Translation uses the word bought, and the Bible in Basic English says the word taken. The original language uses the Hebrew word kalnah, which implies a form of ownership. Purchasing or buying. The same Hebrew word is used in verse 10 for the English translation of purchased. It's also used in verse 9 in the translation of bought. Boaz exercised his legal operation. Boaz exercised his legal option to redeem both the land and Ruth before the appropriate witnesses. And Boaz exercised the spirit of the law and became Ruth's kinsman redeemer. Boaz purchased owning here. It comes from the fact that he took the ownership rights of Ruth and as his own wife for the sake of her deceased husband's name, to keep the family name and heritage going on. Basically, Boaz claimed Ruth as his right under the Torah or the Hebrew law. Or maybe a better way of saying this is that Boaz reclaimed Ruth. Here he is seen as the reclaimer. Oxford Language Dictionary defines the word reclaim as a verb meaning to retrieve or recover something previously lost, given, or paid, to obtain the return of. Jesus Christ did the same type of thing for us when he acted on our behalf, paying the price of sin in full. He purchased us. He reclaimed us. He bought us with his blood. He recovered us, retrieved us out of debt, out of sin and death. Romans 3:23 shares how everyone in this world we are all sinners. All the way back from Adam and Eve, everyone alive today, we are all born in sin and we all sin. We all sin and fall short of God's glory. Romans 6:23 explains that there is a cost, a penalty. The wages of sin is death. Because of sin, we face two types of death. First of all, we have the spiritual death, which is a separation from God, and then the physical death. The spiritual death, as mentioned, is a separation from God. We are unable to fellowship and have a positive relationship with Him. The physical death is an eternal separation from God. Christ went through this. Literally, you might say He had a hell on earth when He took for Himself the sins on the cross. And He cried out, saying, my God, why have thou forsaken me? The Father had to turn His back on Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ had all the sins on him, and God cannot look upon the sins. And that's what hell is. It's a separation from God. And it was through the perfect life that Christ lived, his sacrifice on the cross, his bloodshed, his death, his burial, his resurrection, that we can have everlasting life. We can have everlasting life with God. Christ redeemed us. He reclaimed us. He purchased us with his perfect blood. The second point is response. Response. And we see that in verses 11 through 12, the response. All the people that were in the gate, I imagine there was a good-sized crowd there to see this transaction. There were at least 10 men that we see in this passage here, Boaz and the other kinsmen. But there were more than just these 12 men, as verse 11 states, all the people that were in the gate and the elders. The elders were not counted with all the people. They are added to that number. But as seen previously, the gate was a place for transaction, announcements, many other things occur. Plus the people entering and leaving the city, they travel through the gate. John MacArthur notes that occur plus the people entering and leaving the city travel through the gate. And he notes that this is... Changes here. This affirmation signaled the strong approval of the city. Remember when Naomi returned from Moab, she was greeted by many. A quick research online finds that there was an estimated of anywhere from 300 to 1,000 people in Bethlehem during the setting of Ruth. This is much like the small towns that we live in today, where either everyone is related to everyone or they know someone who is related to everyone. The situation with Naomi and Ruth and now Boaz was most likely well known by the inhabitants of Bethlehem. So all the people that were in the gate became a town-wide event. If you look at the lineage chart, you see Abraham's son Isaac and his son Jacob, who later was named Israel. Jacob had two wives, Rachel, who he loved dearly, and Leah, who was the mother of Judah. And Judah is through the line which we see Boaz, Ruth, and even on down to Jesus Christ. While there are two handmaidens also given in the birth line for some of the 12 tribes of Israel, again, Leah and Rachel are the primary women mentioned. If you would, turn to Genesis chapter 35, verses 19, and Genesis 48, verse 7. Genesis 35, 19 says, "And Rachel died and was buried in the way of Ephrah, which is Bethlehem." And Genesis 48, 7 says, "And as for me, when I came from Paddan, Rachel died by me in the land of Canaan in the way, when yet there was but a little way to come unto Ephrathah. And I buried her there in the way of Ephrath, the same as Bethlehem." So both verses here show how Rachel was buried in Ephrath. That's E-P-H-R-A-T-H, in case you can't see that. That's E-P-H-R-A-T-H, or Ephrathah. E-P-H-R-A-T-H-A-H, depending on which verse, they're both the same. It's now known as Bethlehem, which is the future from the point of Ruth, the future birthplace of the Messiah, as foretold in Micah 5, verse 2. Again, the blessings given unto Ruth by the people of Bethlehem is accomplished through the offspring of Boaz and Ruth, through David, and then eventually on to the Messiah. Verse 12 says, "And let thy house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bare unto Judah, of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman. The lineage we see in the scriptures shows how Judah was born through Leah, through Judah, and the sons and daughter-in-law of the eldest son became a widow. The second son was supposed to carry on the family rights for his brother, but he tried cheating the way out, and the Lord took his life. Tamar, Judah's daughter-in-law, was instructed by Judah to wait till his daughter's son was older, and he never planned on giving his son to her because the other two sons had died. So Tamar took matters into her own hands and immorally consorted with her father-in-law. We see this in Genesis 38:18. Perez, the firstborn of the twins by Tamar, became the main ancestor of the Ephrathites and the Bethlehemites. Again, the line leads us to Boaz, who married Ruth, and on to the Lord. Of the seed by the Hebrews' law, the firstborn son, the firstborn son would be considered to be a child of Ruth's deceased husband, Mahlon, her deceased husband to Mahlon, and additional sons would then be considered the offsprings of Boaz. And it was the first son through the line of Jesus, the line that Jesus comes from. So Boaz is the genetic father by Mahlon and is considered as the parental father. Next point we have is redemption. Redemption. We see this in verses 13 through 14. So the point that we have been waiting for, Boaz and Ruth are married. She has been redeemed. We see this with the point of redemption. Ruth has been redeemed. She is able to continue on as a wife of a Jewish husband. She continues as an Israelite, not a Moabite. And the Lord does not wait around. Ruth conceives a child on her honeymoon, and he gives birth to a son. This, as we've already seen, gives the heritage and the birthrights from Mahlon to Obed, on down to the tree of David, and so forth. The woman of Bethlehem gives praise to the Lord God, for he did not leave Naomi out without a kinsman. The New King James word uses the phrase of a close relative in place of kinsman, who has not left you this day without a close relative, it says, and may his name be famous in Israel. MacArthur comments that this refers to Obed, not Boaz, who cared for Naomi in her later years. Boaz completed the task as he set out to do, that is, ensured that Ruth was redeemed by himself or another. And with this task completed, Ruth was able to reclaim the rights that would have been her deceased husband. The Lord Jesus Christ did something very similar for the entire human race. He bought redemption to us, and as a result, we are given the rights that were once ours when Christ was first formed and created the human race. We can now fellowship with and have a relationship with our God, the Creator. Just as God walked with Adam and Eve in the garden, we now have access to communication, fellowship, and a right relationship with Him. We have been given the gift of redemption. Which brings us to our next point, restoration. Restoration. And we see this in verses 15 through 16. Turn back to chapter 1 and start with verse 19. And remember that Naomi changed her name to Mara when she returned home to Bethlehem. Her husband died. Her two sons had died. One of her daughter-in-laws returned back to her people who worshiped false gods and idols. And upon returning, Naomi really didn't have anything to her name because her husband's land had been sold. She had no more sons to try and reclaim the property, and Naomi was very distraught over everything that occurred over the past. Ruth chapter 1 and verse 19 reads as follows. So that they too, until they came to Bethlehem, so they too went until they came to Bethlehem. And it came to pass when they were come to Bethlehem that all the city was moved about them. And they said, Is this Naomi? And she said unto them, Call me not Naomi, call me Mara. So we see here her name is Mara. The original word used in the scripture by which the we have the translation bitterly, the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. And it comes from the word Mara, and we see here the name Mara comes from that as a symbolic name. It's a symbolic name for how Naomi was feeling. She was bitter. Before we condemn or ridicule Naomi for expressing her bitterness to God, look at our own personal lives. Has something ever gone wrong or gone bad or brought us some form of disaster or chaos? And instead of allowing God to move, motivate, and work through us through the situation, we have become angry or maybe even bitter or upset with God. Naomi wasn't the first to feel and express this anger. She obviously is not the last to do so. Not to justify the situation, but Naomi has been dealt some very harsh blows in her life. But even in the bitterness of her life, she did not turn her back on God. She did not deny him, curse him, draw away from him. In fact, scriptures does not really give us more insight into what really happened, but we see how God had a plan. He had a purpose and a process for redemption. And through this process, Ruth, much like Job and his circumstances, was restored in her lifetime here on earth. She was blessed with a male offspring to continue the family line and the namesake of her husband and son. And look how Ruth is described in the verse. She is much greater. Ruth is much greater for Naomi than she had than had she had seven sons, just by the one son. Seven represents the number of perfection, and thus seven sons would make a complete family. We see that cross-reference in 1 Samuel 2:5. However, Ruth exceeded the standard by herself. Ruth is a blessing upon blessings for Naomi. And as Naomi was restored, her bitterness was turned into joy. Jesus Christ restored us into the family and the fellowship of God, which was once our bitterness, our anger and pain and mourning had been turned into joy, rest, peace, and hope and confidence. And we have been restored in our fellowship with the Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ. Point E is reward. Reward. And we see that in the last verses 17 through 22. How interesting that Ruth, Boaz, or Naomi did not name the child. They did not name the child, but the women in the neighborhood named him Obed. So Ruth and Boaz or Naomi did not name the child. The women in the neighborhood named him Obed. Obed, who was the father of Jesse, who was the father of David, and so on to our Savior, to our Redeemer, our friend Jesus Christ. And Obed means servant. Obez means servant of God or worshiper. Naomi, through Ruth and Boaz, was rewarded. Not only was the reward of rights restored as a result of the kinsman redeemer, but the whole world was rewarded with a Savior who came as a result of the family genealogy. The reward or prize of eternal life is experiencing the blessings of obedience and enjoying God's approval for overcoming the trials by life. Paul directly speaks about the prize of eternal life. 1 Corinthians 9:24 and Philippians 3:14 shares with us, Know ye not that which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize, so run that ye may obtain. Philippians 3:14 says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The prize of eternal life includes both present and future eternal blessings. Our reward comes through Jesus Christ. It comes through Jesus Christ. As he paid the wages of sin, and he paid in full the cost and penalty of our sins. And through him, our Redeemer, the one who has reclaimed us, restored us, has also rewarded us through our personal response of believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, confessing him as Lord and Savior, and receiving his free gift. As we have been viewing a series of videos on the book of Ruth, let's just kind of recap on Ruth here.
The book of Ruth, it's a brilliant work of theological art, and it invites us to reflect on the question of how God is involved in the day-to-day joys and hardships of our lives. Boaz, remember, he knows Ruth's true character, and so he acquires the family property of Naomi, and he marries Ruth. And so just at the beginning, how Ruth was loyal to Naomi's family, so now Boaz is loyal to Naomi's family as well. The story concludes with a reversal of all of the tragedies from chapter 1. So the death of the husband and the sons is reversed as Ruth is married again and gives birth to a new son, granting joy to Naomi. And this symmetry between the opening and the closing, it's even more remarkable. So remember, the opening tragedy was followed by a great act of loyalty on the part of Ruth. And that is now matched by Boaz's act of loyalty that leads to the family's final restoration. And this symmetry, it highlights the design of the internal chapters as well. So each of the chapters begins with Naomi and Ruth making a plan for their future. And that's followed by a providential meeting between Ruth and Boaz. And each chapter concludes with Naomi and Ruth rejoicing at what's taken place. This story is beautifully designed. And that design actually connects with a really interesting feature of the story. And that's how little God is mentioned, right? The characters talk about God a few times, but the narrator actually never once mentions God doing anything directly in the story. And that's its brilliance. Because God's providence is at work behind every scene of this story, weaving together the circumstances and choices of all these characters. So Naomi, her tragedy leads her to think that God is punishing her. But actually, the whole story is about God's mission to restore her and her family. And he's doing so through Ruth, through her boldness and loyalty, which brings healing to Naomi's life, but not without Boaz, who's a no-nonsense farmer who's full of generosity and loyalty. And so God uses his integrity combined with Ruth's boldness to save Naomi and her family. And so this story brilliantly explores the interplay of God's purposes and will with human decision and will. God weaves together the faithful obedience of his people to bring about his redemptive purposes in the world. And that leads to the real end of the story. The book of Ruth concludes with a genealogy showing how Boaz and Ruth's son, Obed, was the grandfather of King David, from whom came the lineage of the Messiah. And so all of a sudden, these seemingly mundane, ordinary events in this story are woven into God's grand story of redemption for the whole world. And so the book of Ruth invites us to consider how God might be at work in the very ordinary, mundane details of our lives as well. And that's what the book of Ruth is all about.
And I don't know how well you can see the screen, but the main points again are reclaimer, response, redemption, restoration, and reward. And that is what we're talking about today, is the reward that we have through Jesus Christ, through the salvation that we have by his gift, by his sacrifice, through his death, his burial, and resurrection, which is also part of why we celebrate the Christmas season, the coming of the Messiah. Let's go ahead and close in a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we come before you, as we've glanced through the book of Ruth, and it's a picture story of you and Jesus Christ being our kinsman redeemer, that we may have everlasting life, salvation granted again unto us, so that we may have again fellowship with you. Father, we just thank you for the story of Ruth, and that through it we see the birth of Jesus Christ, the one who gave us eternal life. And we thank you again for the opportunity to fellowship with you, to be reconnected with you, to be restored. Father, we just, as we're looking upon this Christmas season, help us to remember the true meaning of Christmas, that Jesus Christ came to bring us eternal life, and help us to live our life in a way that brings you glory and honor. Father, I lift our heavenly family before you. I ask your blessings on each and every one. As we travel throughout this day and throughout this week, I just pray for your safety encouragement with each and every one. We lift them before you in Jesus' name. Amen.